So, very welcome, Helga. Now we meet here on Zoom. You are sitting in Iceland and you are the lucky geologist.
I am, definitely.
Yeah, how come that you are the lucky geologist?
Yeah, because it's not every day that a geologist can witness a volcanic eruption close to hometown and completely safe. And this has just been a very nice break from the COVID pandemic, let's say.
Mm.
So we have something else in the news than just COVID. So yeah, I'm very lucky. I've been there already a couple of times.
Oh, nice.
So okay, no, I can't stop going
you live
there.
Really close on the Reykjanes area?
It's 20, it's 30 minutes drive from Reykjavik. So this area is volcanic area. And when I've taken my tourists around the area, I've always told them, we are expecting a volcanic eruption in this area soon, because there are eruptions every 800,000 years in this area.
Yeah.
And now we have it, so.
Yeah, a very nice touristic attraction.
Luckily, it's during a pandemic, because otherwise we could never manage all the tourists going there, I think, because it's so accessible. Usually the volcanic eruptions in Iceland are remote area, middle of nowhere. But this is just, we call it tourist eruption.
Yeah, tourist. It's very safe. So as we heard.
Yeah, exactly.
And the picture we used to announce this interview was this black wall and your sister just in front of this black lava wall. Since I'm a photographer as well and I'm an Iceland fan, I really, really like the picture. I wanted to ask you if it's just something for your family memories, like a book, or does it mean much more to yourself?
You mean the volcano? Or...
Yeah, and the picture you made.
Oh, the picture, yeah.
Sister, it was so strong.
Yeah, it's just, even though, I mean, the eruption is very noisy and, you know, cracks and just very powerful. And you can get so close. And then at the same time, it's so, quiet, peaceful in a way.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, you go there, you don't stop for half an hour, you stop for 3-4 hours. You can't just stop enjoying it. It's
mesmerizing.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And can you explain why and how the volcanic activity is developing so well in your home country?
Yeah, I can. And
this one.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this is the planet, and you can see, so within in the core of the planet, we have a magma chamber, just boiling magma, basically. And from the core, there are several like magma strokes, we call it, to the surface of the planet. And you can see the magma strokes on this picture. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. One magma stroke is below Hawaii, for example, and another one is below Iceland. So with constant volcanic activity. I mean, we have a volcanic eruption in Iceland on average, maybe every 10 years or so, even less. Last one we had was 2014. And before that, 2010, Eyjafjallajökull, which the whole globe remembers because it stopped air traffic over Europe for 2 weeks. So it's very active and it's constantly changing the landscape.
Mm-hmm.
So if you give us the next slide, please.
Mm-hmm.
So the crust of the planet is composed of tectonic plates. There are Eurasian plate, American plate, the Indian plate. India is actually moving, cresting up into the Eurasian plate, forming the Himalayas, the mountains. So basically just crust piling up. And other places, the tectonic plates are moving away from each other, like the Atlantic Ridge, which goes from the south to all the way to the north. Mm-hmm. The red line on this picture, this is the Atlantic Ridge. So mm-hmm. the European plate to the right is moving towards east, and the American plate is moving towards west. And Iceland is above the Atlantic Ridge, which means Iceland is getting bigger, basically, because the two plates are moving apart, away from each other.
And how many centimeters a year?
Around 1 centimeter a year.
Okay.
So slowly we are taking over the world, by one centimeter a year. But yeah, the volcanic activity is kind of filling the void, which means, yeah, Iceland is growing. And you can, maybe you can show us the next picture.
Mm-hmm.
It's from, yeah.
This is...
It shows the Atlantic Ridge, how it goes through Iceland. Yeah. So you can see the pink lines, how the Atlantic Ridge is stretching from the south below the Reykjanes Peninsula, which is the southwest corner of Iceland, and also in the south coast. And then they come together between the two glaciers, the white spots, and then continue towards the north. This is the Atlantic Ridge. So below there, on this zone, the plates are moving apart. So the violet purple colors, this is the part of Iceland that's oldest. There's hardly any activity there anymore. And you can see the Reykjanes Peninsula, the southwest part of Iceland. It's all pink and red. These are all like fissure systems, volcanic systems. Mm-hmm. And we have eruptions there on average every 800,000 years, and now we have eruption, and it might be we will have more frequent eruptions in this peninsula for the next maybe 100 years.
Ah, how do you know?
Because we have like phases of volcanic eruptions spanning maybe 100, 200 years, and then quiet period for some time because the magma is already above the surface. And then the magma chamber below, it has to refill to come to the surface again.
Mm-hmm.
So this Reykjanes Peninsula is where we have the volcanic eruption at the moment. And Reykjavik is on the north corner, like northernmost tip of this peninsula. So we are very, very close to the volcano. There was an earthquake last night in Hengil area, which is close to Reykjavik. It's maybe 40 kilometers, 30 kilometers.
Mm-hmm.
We had a 3.8, I think, if I'm correct, earthquake this morning in that area.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not connected to the volcanic eruption. It's because of the two plates moving apart. It's tectonics.
All right. Mm-hmm.
In Iceland, we have 20, 30 earthquakes per day somewhere in Iceland. Mm-hmm. So it's not uncommon to feel an earthquake. Going to bed, I'm lying in my bed, and it shakes a little bit. It was an earthquake.
All right. Yeah.
Yeah. But they're usually small. Mm-hmm. And the crust is new, so porous compared to old crust like Greenland. So the earthquakes are not very fatal. And so we don't have bad, you know, damage in our earthquakes, not much. And we are not very urbanized country, so not much damage.
Do you follow any forecast. So as we would follow the weather forecast, do you follow the earthquake forecast or the volcanic?
Not really. Mm-hmm. Not even the weather forecast, because the weather here changes every 5 minutes and it's hard to predict. Mm-hmm. So why bother?
Yeah.
The forecast is always wrong.
Yeah.
So, but you know, it's at the moment I'm going to the website. Yeah. For
yeah,
sure.
So
because
can,
I want to know what's happening.
Yeah. Yeah. We can show the website so that shows the actual. Where do we have this? Yeah. What do we see here?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This is the peninsula that I showed you on the map, last map. And you see the purple area on in the north? It's Reykjavik city. Keflavik is to the west of Reykjavik, as where the international airport is located. And all those dots are earthquakes, and you see the green one, it's a star, that's the high peak at just before noon today. It was 3.8. you can see mm-hmm. it below the picture. You see dots, lines and dots. These are the earthquakes that are happening in the peninsula, and the 3.8, quite strong, it's the green star. And as you can see, I mean, there's an earthquake every hour,
yeah.
every half an hour on average in this peninsula. So, and we can feel them, 3.8 we can feel. Two, mm-hmm. we can't really feel.
So the glass is shaking in the cupboard, so on the table.
No, not 3.8.
Okay.
It's mm-hmm. just the movement. You can mm-hmm. feel it if you're sitting or in your bed. You can feel it, the bed is shaking or, you know. But if it's it's above 4, you can feel it. And we have had strong earthquakes before the eruption. We had strong earthquakes, very strong, 5, you know, above mm-hmm. almost every other day.
Mm-hmm.
That's not common. In year 2000 we had earthquake 6.4, and 2008 another one above 6, and then since last year, we had many strong earthquakes because the magma was just trying to squeeze through the crust, and now we have the eruption. So we don't have many earthquakes since the eruption started.
Mm-hmm.
So we get the eruption when the plates are moving apart, like we had this morning, or the magma is squeezing up through the crust, trying to get to the surface, then we also have earthquakes.
Yeah, sounds a little bit dangerous as well. Can it be dangerous for civilization?
Not, I mean, of course, if you have, it's not wise to have a bookshelf above behind your bed. It's not recommended, you know. But I mean, it doesn't affect normal life here. The houses here are built very strong, on a solid ground and with thick concrete. So the houses are supposed to take the earthquakes, and it's mainly Hveragerði and Selfoss. They are towns east of here, and they are very close to epicenters of some earthquakes. Mm-hmm. So there have been damage, but I never heard anyone dying because of an earthquake.
And when it comes to volcanic eruptions, so I've heard there are evacuation plans for the south of Iceland. Are there some for your area?
Yeah, not. It's the eruptions in Iceland are usually basaltic, so very slow, like you've seen on the pictures, and mm-hmm. you can be close. So we don't have to prepare evacuation in Reykjavik, for example, not anytime soon, but if it's going to approach to Reykjavik, we have to prepare if it's going to, you know, or destroy a village, Grindavik, for example. I mean, if it's approaching the town, we have to, of course, prepare for evacuating. But there is a town in the south called Vík, which mm-hmm. is close to Eyjafjallajökull, that erupted in 2010. And that village is close to Katla. Katla volcano, mm-hmm. which has also, like Eyjafjallajökull, a glacier on the top. And when you have a glacier on top of a volcano, it's explosive, like in Eyjafjallajökull. So as, you know, blowing high up in the air. And so it's explosive. And a lot of material that's going to flood, you know, from below the glacier. And these villages, they have evacuation plans for Katla eruption, if Katla is going to erupt. Mm-hmm. Because the flood, it can possibly be flooded. Mm-hmm. And we are expecting a volcanic eruption in Katla as well, because Katla erupts every 100 years on average. And last time was 1918. So 103 years ago, mm-hmm. and we've had last year and 2 years ago, they had, there were like yellow alerts and orange alerts because they were monitoring and monitoring many earthquakes and gases, but it still hasn't erupted. So mm-hmm. we are waiting.
Some more phenomena of Mother Nature.
Yeah. Oh yeah. It's not boring. Iceland is not boring.
How do people prepare, for example, who are the inhabitants of Vík or who live close
in Vík? We have the civil protection and also the scientists, and they plan, they have plans for this you know, this village, so they make plans. And we, of course, they have predicted possible ways for the floods, and I've seen the predictions, and they don't seem to be going over the village, but we never know.
Yeah, I know. So. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you are a scientist as well, and you did research about the climate in mm-hmm. the Arctic. Does the volcanic eruption has any effect on the climate change or on the climate?
Okay, so I have a slide for that. If you can show the last slide with the text.
Mm-hmm. Wait a minute, a second. On the
share. I call it humans against volcanoes mm-hmm. because there is a myth that we don't have to worry because we have volcanoes that are, you know, erupting and polluting. So, do you have a slide?
Yeah, is it with the text, humans against volcanoes?
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Each year, humanity releases about 37 billion tons of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere by burning coal and oil and gas. As a result, more than 100 million tons of greenhouse gases are added to the atmosphere every day. And measurements by the Earth Institute indicate that the eruption that's happening now in Iceland releases between 4,000 to 7,000 tons CO2 every day.
Okay, really tiny. Yeah.
4,000 against 100 million tons.
Yeah.
So annual greenhouse gas emission from all the world's volcanoes is on average around 300 to 400 million tons per year.
Hmm.
Whereas it's 37 billion tons by each year by humanity. So you can see.
So
mankind has only 3 days to emit as much greenhouse gas as all of Earth's volcanoes do in a single year. So we don't have to worry about the volcanoes. And volcanic eruptions are usually short, and the fire we burn to power society is 100 times the size of all the world's volcanoes and is constantly rising day after day, year after year, for decades. And and also, we have to also remember, volcanoes have been there forever, and they are part of the slow natural carbon cycle. And So they slowly release carbon into the atmosphere that the ocean life and the rocks absorb over time. So the carbon cycle is in balance. But we humans, since the industrial revolution in 800, 60, 70, the carbon cycle has been disrupted. And we have changed the carbon cycle balance by destroying land and soil and burning fossil fuels on a massive scale. So nature cannot keep up with us.
Yep.
So there's a myth that we have to worry about the volcanoes. That,
All right. They are not this is good. So the volcano is already a tourist attraction, and there are already tourists coming now slowly, but they're coming. Is it good for Iceland?
Not really. I mean, because like New Zealand is doing, they kind of closed the country, kind of. So they are saving the domestic economy. So they don't have to shut down the, you know, shut down the lockdown. They don't have to do lockdown.
Yeah.
Whereas Iceland, you can come to Iceland. You have to, if you're vaccinated, it's not a problem.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not, and you have COVID, like happened a few days ago, there was from Europe, but he lives in Iceland. He came. He didn't quarantine. He had COVID, and it spreads like, you know.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh. Yeah, microphone. The microphone is muted.
Yeah, no. Sorry. Instead of preserve, you know, having stricter at the border, last summer was pretty good for tourism because all the local people were traveling, and we have a lot of money to travel, so. The hotels were full in the south, and the restaurants, people couldn't book a table because all the local people were traveling. Same for this summer. People are not booking a vacation abroad. They are booking vacation in Iceland.
Mm-hmm.
And if we have COVID and we cannot do that,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
It what's the point? It's not.
Yeah. So that leads me to that question. You're working in the sustainable tourism as well. So what are models or ideas for the future? How can people come, and how can it look like?
So book directly with a hotel or operator. Don't book through Booking, because 20-30% goes into the Silicon Valley or America. So book directly. That's sustainable, you know, if you book directly with a provider.
Mm-hmm.
And also book like local hotel run by the family, not Hilton. Mm-hmm. Sorry. No offense, but book with the locals and on the locals restaurant as well. Many restaurants in Iceland, for example, are using local food. We have amazing restaurant in close to on the Golden Circle that I recommend everyone to go, and I go there with my people. It's actually a greenhouse. So Iceland produces 100% green energy. It's geothermal and hydro. So we are not burning fossil fuels for electricity. So the only pollution is the cars, ships, and the planes.
Wow.
And we also heat the houses with hot water. So it's completely green. Hot water. This greenhouse is close to geothermal spot, and they use the hot water both to heat the greenhouse and produce electricity. So they are growing tomatoes all year.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. And we should focus, Iceland should focus on greenhouses and grow our own food, local food, because we don't need pesticides. There are no bugs here, few bugs. And this tomato farm, buyers, consumers, they often prefer a straight cucumber to a bent one.
Oh,
so, So they have to throw it away, which is crazy. So instead of throwing the tomatoes away, the bad ones, they open the restaurant inside where they're using the tomatoes for everything that's on the menu. Tomato soup, tomato pasta, tomato beer, tomato ice cream, everything. Yeah. So this example is, this is the future.
Yeah.
So I tell people, don't miss this when you're here.
Great. So, these are some great advices and some great hints for the next travel season. There is hopefully one.
Yeah.
And maybe we all, can stay a little bit more quiet for the next weeks and months, and then plan ahead for the next year or for the autumn or whenever. What's the best season then for Iceland to come
to Iceland? I always recommend end of August or September, because it's still warm and we have the northern lights.
Mm-hmm.
So, and you can still, the highlands are still open, so you can go to central Iceland, whereas in the winter and spring it's not possible because it's full of snow.
Mm-hmm.
So I suggest end of August, September, fewer tourists and northern lights, and it's still pretty warm, and September is very often a very pretty month.
Mm-hmm. I remember myself more than 10 years ago, I've seen my first northern lights sitting in Iceland in a hot pot, watching the sky and the northern lights. That was really amazing. I wasn't prepared to make any pictures. I would be better prepared today, but this was a moment I would never forget. Yeah,
sometimes you just have to enjoy.
Yeah.
Forget the technology.
Yeah, right. That is totally right. So any message regarding climate change, sustainability, volcanoes you would tell our fans?
Travel is not very clean, of course, but I believe we can still travel in a sustainable way if we support the local communities and leave the money in the local community. And of course, we have greenwashing, like planting trees instead of our flights, which is most of the airlines are offering. Mm-hmm. I call it greenwashing.
Yeah.
It makes you feel better.
Yeah.
For us in Iceland, it's hard for us not to take a flight to travel. But for Europe, you can take the train. And I know more people are choosing the train. And I think it's Spain or France that are stopping domestic flights.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah, but we cannot take a train from Iceland to Europe, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
we can take the ferry.
Yeah,
but yeah,
it takes 3 days.
takes 3 days, exactly. So that's not an option for us. So, but yeah.
Yeah, that's good to know. So to look at the small things you can do and support the locals.
They all matter, the small things.
Yeah.
If you think I'm gonna take the plastic bag, I'm just one of 7 billion people. But if everyone thinks like that, nothing's gonna change. But if everyone takes a little step, it makes difference.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Unfortunately, the destruction of the environment and the planet is very,
Yeah.
Everyone, children even, are aware of the threat we have the planet is facing by us, the humans.
Yeah, so right.
That's good.
Yeah. I'm very happy to have the chance to hear you, to talk to you. Thank you very, very much. And to share your knowledge about the volcanoes and the climate and everything. Very nice. We will share the link then when we publish the recordings, and hope we stay in contact.
Yeah, thank you so much for the opportunity.
Yeah, thank you.